In this session, we are going to look into pods. Pods are the smallest deployable unit that can be created and managed within Kubernetes. Pods are the objects that run inside nodes, and you can have multiple pods running inside one node. Pods are nothing but a wrapper over the containers. Containers are always running inside pod. In Kubernetes world, that's the way you run your container. You can have multiple containers running inside pods. Pods is nothing but a ring-fence environment which provides the network state, volumes, and kernel namespace to the containers. And you can have multiple containers inside a pod, and they share the same pod environment. If you have multiple containers running inside a pod, let's understand more. So I have a web application and a log collector agent. These are the two containers running inside a pod. The web application writes the log messages to a shared file system. And the same file system is available to log collector agent, which reads the logs and sends it to the central logging service. So that's how you can have multiple containers doing separate job within the pod. And this specific pattern is called sidecar pattern. To scale application within Kubernetes, you can't have multiple containers running inside the pod. The right way to scale is have multiple pods for the same type of application running in Kubernetes cluster, which can be scheduled on different nodes as well. Let's look at the pod lifecycle. So once client requests for a new pod to be created, the first pod goes into the pending state. And you remember the scheduler. Scheduler assigns node for the pending pod. Once the node picks up that, it starts the container and goes into the running state. For any reason, if it can't be allocated or not run, it goes into the failed state. From running state, again, it can go to failed or succeed state as a end state. So if you want to read more about lifecycle and phases for pod, you can read on the Kubernetes documentation. But this is the high level lifecycle of the pod. It starts with the pending state, running, either failed or succeed at the end. One of the key concept for understanding pod is to understand pod networking. Two containers within a pod shares the network's namespace, right? So they can talk to each other via simple localhost. And Kubernetes cluster runs its own virtual private network. So the networking within the Kubernetes cluster is independent of the outside network. So from that virtual private network, each pod gets assigned one IP address. So each pod has its own unique IP address. And multiple pods in Kubernetes cluster talks to each other via the IP address allocated to the pod. Now, question comes is that how to create and manage pod within Kubernetes cluster? And you know the answer, the pod descriptor YAML, right? So everything is defined in YAML files. The first part is API version, which is the specification version that we are going to use. The client is pod, the metadata where we specify the name of the pod, and the specification part where we specify the container details. So which image I want to run, what port to expose, and the name of the container that I want to specify within the pod. Container specification has many other attributes and tags. Like you can pass in the command line arguments. You can specify the working directory. You can pass in the environment and set the environment variable for the containers. You can volume mount. You can specify the liveness and readiness probe. You can specify image pull policy for the container. Now let's see it working. So I have my Kubernetes cluster running with three worker node and one master. So I'm connected to my VirtualBox Kubernetes cluster that I have set up. So in this window, I'm going to do the watch on pods. I don't have any pods running in the default namespace. So that's why you don't see any of the pods here. So first, let's look at the pod descriptor that I have. So I have three pod descriptor. I'll show you one by one. The first one is the Nginx container that I want to run. So it's a simple Nginx image exposed on port 80, and the name of the pod is Nginx. Second is hello node application that we have seen in the Docker, which is right now I have pushed it to the Docker Hub, so I can pull it from Docker Hub directly from there. So the third pod that will run is a Dobby application. Dobby application is application that is written in Go, which has some specific endpoints available like health, readiness, version, and meta. And it has some endpoints like false-sake and all that, which we'll use further. This application is built by colleagues at ThoughtWorks from Chennai office. Three applications, Nginx, Hello Node application, and Dobby. Okay, let's run all this application, right? So the command to run the Kubernetes pod is kubectl apply minus f nginx.yaml. You'll notice that the pod is getting created here. I'm watching on the pod. So it shows one of one, which means one container inside this pod. And if you notice, the pod got scheduled on Kubernetes node 2. I have three nodes running, right? If you remember, so kubectl get nodes. I have three worker nodes, 1, 2, and 3. So it can get assigned to any of the node, right? It's taking time. Let's do a quickly. Kubectl describe is another command to see what's going on. Describe pod Nginx. So now it has started. When you do describe, it shows you what's going on inside the pod. So first it's pulling the image Nginx. Then it successfully pulled the image. So it took around 30 seconds to download the image on my VirtualBox, right? And then it started the container. Let's run the Node.js. Quickly, let's look at the describe the pod. So we'll notice that it is still pulling the image from the server. Still taking time. If you notice, hello node pod is assigned to worker node 1. And both of the pods got the IP address as well. Now, if I go ahead and describe hello node, you'll see it has successfully pulled the image, container created, and it's all good. Now let's apply the third application, Dobby. It's got assigned to node 3. All the pods are up and running. Nginx pod is running on node 2. Hello World Node.js application is running on node 1, and Dobby is running on node 3. See the log kubectl logs and specify the pod name, hello node. I can see the logs and say logs Dobby, show you the logs from the Dobby application that is printed here. If I want to access the endpoint, I cannot access from here. If I try from my host machine, say curl 10.244.2.2, it won't be accessible slash meta. It is not accessible because. So first, what I have to do is I have to get inside one of the worker node or master. So one of the machines in the Kubernetes cluster. So I'll do vagrant ssh k8s node 2. I'm inside one of the worker node. From here, I shall be able to connect and access the pod IP. So if I clear this, I do curl 10.244.2.2:4444/meta. I see the response from the pod. If I go ahead and hit another endpoint, I get the version. That's one way to access. What is another way? From one pod, am I able to connect to another pod using the pod IP or not? For that, first I have to get inside one of the container. Kubectl exec is the command. So I'm right now inside the hello node pod. So right now using the exec command, I have got inside the container of hello node pod. So if I go here, I can do wget. See, I got the same response, right? So from one pod, hello node, I am able to access Dobby application via IP address. So that's how you can communicate between pods. Let me exit from here now. Now let's see some more parameters to the specification part, right? So if I want to pass some environment variable, I can pass environment variable to my container using env attribute. I'm saying version set to 2.0. So right now when we hit the version, it shows some 1.0 something for the Dobby version, right? Remember that the name is same. Okay, first I have to delete the old pod. Notice it is getting terminated and gone. Now I have to apply the Dobby application with version. Notice that application pod is getting created running on node 3. This time it works fast because the image was already present there. I have to see if the version is set correctly as environment variable to go inside the Dobby application, right? So say Dobby minus IT interactive, right? Now inside the Dobby application, I can say echo, right? I see the version 2.0. So now if I want to see the version from the another application, I can do, I can get inside the Hello World application, Hello World pod, and see, I can do the wget again. And you'll notice that you can see version 2.0. The same image, it's just that I have changed, I've given the environment property. So if you notice here, I have passed the version as an environment property and which is picked up by the Dobby application. One of the feature that the Dobby application has is it can crash. So if I hit endpoint, it says crash, then it's going to kill the process which is running there, right? So if I go inside Dobby and I can say ps, I see that the Dobby server is running as process ID 1. The lifecycle of the container is driven by the process ID 1, right? So if I crash this process ID 1, let's see what happens to the pod, right? The container is going to stop, right? Okay, to hit the endpoint, let's hit it from the worker node. So I'm on the worker node 2 here in this terminal window. I'm just putting the curl to crash. Let's see what happens here. This status went into the error. Okay. And it started again, right? Within some time it started, but you notice that there is a restart count which is increased from 0 to 1. So first resiliency level provided by Kubernetes pods is that if your container crashes for any reason, the container is going to get restarted in the same pod. That's how first level of resiliency is provided by Kubernetes. So if I do it again, let's watch it. Went into the error state, 0 of 1 container is running, restart count is 1. And in some time you will notice that it is again into running state with restart count 2. See, now it is in the running state, restart count 2, and 1 of 1 container is ready and serving the request. So we have seen all about a single container running inside a pod. Now let's look at multiple container. So this is the descriptor YAML for multiple container pod. So in multiple container, my first pod is named as first. The image is Nginx exposing container port 80. I am mounting a volume in mount path, which is used by Nginx to serve the actual HTML files. In the second container, it's a simple Debian container. Again, I am mounting a mount path at HTML. And the command that I keep running here in the while loop, which keeps appending date to my index.html file in the same volume mount. So in this case, the volume HTML is shared between first container and second container. And that's how my two containers are using the same volume mount. We'll learn more about volume mount in a persistent storage session, but right now just assume that this is how you share the volumes. Now let's deploy this. One thing that you will notice immediately is you see here 0 of 2. This is the column which tells you that how many containers are running inside pod and how many of them are in the healthy ready state. Okay, we got both the containers running. Go inside the container. Let's say kubectl exec multi container. And I have to specify which container I want to go in, which is first, right? I'm inside this, I'll open another window, right? I'll just connect to my Kubernetes cluster. So I'm inside the second container here, right? Now I can check the mount path here, mount. So I have /HTML mounted. So as I do tail -f /HTML /index.html. And this is in the second container. If I go here, I say mount grep HTML. This is a path. I go here and do tail -f index.html. Both of these is sharing the same file. If you see, right? So that's how you can have a multi-container running inside a pod. If you want to see the running Nginx, I go to my node, one of the worker nodes. I just do curl, and then I specify IP address 10.244.3.3. And you see this file, which is printed, right? Which is index.html. In this exercise, we have to create a pod. And we'll continue to use the same application that we use in Docker session, right? So what we'll do is like, we'll create a pod specification for metadata service. And to create a pod specification, you can use your own image that you have published to the Docker Hub or published for you, which is sunitparekh/metadata version 1.0. To verify the application running, you can get inside a container or go to the node by just typing minikube ssh, and you can check the logs, or you can hit the endpoint /actuator/info.